Jay Gah, Utomi, and others form a coalition to oust APC and the PDP. Plus, the PDP may be trying to jettison its zoning arrangement. This is Fox Politics, and I am Mary Ann Nicole. Ahead of the 2023 general elections, some Nigerians of diverse professional backgrounds converged to express lack of confidence in the nation's two popular political parties, the ruling All Progressive Congress, the APC, and the opposition People's Democratic Party, the PDP. They said the quest to rescue Nigeria from imminent danger informed the idea to form a coalition which would serve as a platform to galvanize Nigerians across political spectrum to free the country from its current woes and give it a fresh lease of life. This does sound familiar, doesn't it? Well, joining us to discuss is political analyst Biodun Showomi, political technocrat Dayo Kayode, and former member of the All Progressive Congress State Working Committee in River State, Sugbeye Ilai. Thank you very much, gentlemen.
Good evening. Nice having you.
Yes. So I'm going to start with you, Mr. Showomi. This is, like I said in my intro, this sounds more like something we hear every political cycle, where the politicians, you know, start speaking about changing and rescuing the masses, which I hate the word masses, but they always talk about, you know, changing the fortunes of Nigeria, and always pointing to either their political party or some initiative that they have. But then there have been questions about the third force and what particular change it can really bring, and if it can really stand a chance against the two major political parties.
Yes, it's becoming a swan song. Every election cycle, we tend to hear more progressive elements coming together, wanting to form a new platform to challenge the two parties in Nigeria. There are two issues involved. One is their frustration with the existing structures in the country. One, either the remaining political parties are too weak, you know, to be used as a platform to challenge, or the two ruling parties have failed, you know, to make the necessary impact in terms of developmental life expectations of the people. And therefore, they feel so frustrated by it and then choose, you know, to look for a different platform where they can, you know, express not only their own political ambition, at the same time, you know, strive to try and develop or achieve whatever they think they need to achieve in terms of development. Now, you then ask yourself, why a new political party? Why not one out of the existing parties? But when you look at the existing political parties, one thing which is common in all is that many of them, if not most of them, are actually formed, you know, by different, you know, personalities in the two major political parties. They are the ones bankrolling it in expectation to use them as a vehicle if they have a disagreement.
I'm sorry, are you saying that there are people in the APC and the PDP sponsoring the third force, and this might just be a distraction of sorts?
No. The existing political parties, we have more than two political parties in Nigeria, registered political parties. Many of those registered political parties in existence today are backed behind the scene by and financed by, you know, members of the existing two political parties. So that is where they may feel frustrated by it and think of having a different umbrella. But again, it could also, the argument could also be self-serving, because you have parties like National Conscience Party, some one or two or three political parties, you know, with left ideological leanings, which you and I know were formed, you know, not necessarily by people with money bags. Now, how do they come in and then take over those political structures? They may not be allowed to do that. So because of that, they choose to, at every election, try and come together, present a different platform. But at the end of the day, nothing has always been coming out of. Whether this one will be different or not, we don't know. Mm. But given the experience in the past, many of these characters, you know, were involved in formation of new political parties, you know, in past electoral cycle. When you look at the only difference this time is that you have people like Atayu Jega now involved. Otherwise, you ask yourself, it's like a swan song, it's becoming a barber's chair. So with Jega's involvement, we don't know what has changed or what will change. It remains to be seen.
Okay. Now, Sogbeye, you are a member of the All Progressive Congress, the ruling party, and I mean, suffice it to say that your party merged like this as a combination of different political parties to unseat the ruling party at the time, which was the People's Democratic Party. Now, I remember when Professor Jega initially came up with the idea of, you know, the third force and spoke about the ills of the Buhari administration and all of the low points. The APC government struck back, saying that he was only pushing his presidential ambition. And I'm wondering what's wrong with that. If the APC has succeeded by becoming a coalition of sorts, why can't the third force be same?
Thanks for having me. First and foremost, I will just say it is within the rights of Professor Atayu Jega and others to form political associations and vie for any political office of their choice. At the core of this, she is trying to get a national estate fixed. And every Nigerian has a right under the Constitution to be in one party or move into another party or form a coalition with other people to pursue their respective aspirations. But the question would be this: for how long would you have this game of rocking chairs? If you have, for instance, from the Second Republic onwards, when we had the NPN, the MPP, and the UPN, and the sorts, imagine for once that there's no interruption, and we build on those parties till now, like the ANC in South Africa, we have had institutions that can deliver on the manifestos of the parties, not shifting grounds every 4 years, every election cycle. Some people break away, want to form a new party, tell Nigeria the same story, and then move on, and then they're unable to deliver the next 4 years election cycle, another team breaks out. I had Biodun say, maybe with Professor Atayu Jega, this might be different. I disagree. One or two smart elects, with respect to them, who are behind this, probably want to find a credible face. When I mean credible face, I'm simply saying that Jega, from his background as ASUU national president, who kept me at home for 1 year with ASUU strike, I mean, I can't forget that, and then went on to conduct a national election that was deemed to be free and fair to a large extent. My party won. I may want to excuse myself from sounding too upbeat about that. So it doesn't look like while I'm giving credit to Jega, I'm saying that because my party won.
Well, I'm really waiting to hear where this goes. Kind of,
Yeah, now, but people are saying that next to the one that was conducted and produced is Chief MQ Abiola in 1993, June 12th, that election appeared to be a leap forward from the one that Professor Obasanjo did in 2007 that brought about Professor Yar'Adua. Remember, Yar'Adua himself, at the inauguration, alluded to that fact that the election that brought him to power was tainted and the promised reforms, which reforms he carried out, unfortunately couldn't finish before he died. But I'm saying in all is, some people are smart enough to bring Jega on board this movement to give it a credible face. Because, name them, Osman Bugaje was one of those who led us in the new PDP, after the PDP, to form the APC. He has his man Friday there as well, in the Saraki family. Abdul Fada Ahmed, who was immediate past governor of Kwara State, is in that team. And then from Pat Tommy, who until recently I know is an APC member. I don't know why he has left the party, but he's there. And then who again? These are old names. Who know them? And they know us too. But what we're saying is, people should set a national agenda. This is where I want Nigeria to be in the next 5 years. next 10 years, 15, and so on and so forth. And then work within the parties to deliver on those promises, not to shift political parties every 4-year cycle. You create confusion because we don't have ideologies, we don't have principles.
I'm thinking, I know that you're talking to the viewers, but I'm wondering, because it sounds like you're preaching to the choir. You're a member of the ruling party, and you're talking about the rotating barber's chair and the fact that we're doing the same thing over and over again. Well, I thought that the APC promised that they were going to bring a change of source, that they were going to change the situation of things in Nigeria, including the electoral process, by fighting corruption, by bringing an end to insecurity, by making sure that the economy is boosted. So if we're still talking about the same thing in 2021 and we have 2 more years in the cycle of this APC administration, can we say that the APC has failed and maybe we should look for another person to sit on that chair, that rotating barber's chair again?
No, it would be very unfair to the APC to come to that conclusion with respect. With the greatest respect, that would be the height of fairness, if you like, for want of the right word. The APC met a colossal disaster on the ground. And in trying to rebuild...
Which they promised to deal with.
Crash, we have met our challenges. But we're soldiering on. Sorry?
You said they met a coercive disaster, and I'm saying they promised, they saw the disaster, they knew about it, and that's why they decided to run. So it's not supposed to be news, is it?
We're not shying from responsibility. We're working hard. We've rolled up our sleeves since 2015. We're working hard. It's just that some of those problems, we probably underestimated them. And of course, don't forget, in this country, we have a country where people play politics for everything. We've seen people who want to give the APC a name of it, like give a dog a bad name to destroy it. Some people have actually magnified the problems that we met because they must give APC a bad name to make us look like you and PDP and say we're not the same. Some elements in APC came from the PDP who agree, but there are top progressives in APC who also were in PDP before now, but are chasing an ideal to make sure they deliver the mandates.
Okay.
And that's what makes us different.
Okay.
So if anybody says he wants to challenge the status quo, let him come forward with ideas. But I'm saying that this idea of having the core politicians break out every now and then doesn't make sense. We're not building institutions. We should build institutions, not just moving political parties.
Let me go to Mr. Dayokayode. You are a political technocrat. And the question on the average Nigerian's mind is, what difference will this third force make? We've heard third force. The first time we heard about it was some people said that the former president, Olusegun Obasanjo, was pushing it. We've heard it again and again. And now we have the likes of Professor Patutomi. We have Professor Jega, and other people, fronting. Again, what is the ideology? Is it going to be different? Is there anything that Nigerians can really hold on to in this third force? Or should we just look at it as another political gimmick?
Yeah, thank you very much for having me on this platform to discuss this very vital issue that is evolving in our country at this moment in time. You see, my own satellite, I started some about 3 or 4 weeks ago when Professor Jega came on air to say, look, PDP have disappointed us. APC is also disappointing presently. Why can't we in 2023 look elsewhere? And then I asked a question. Where are we going to look at? And I advised Professor Jega. I said, much as I respect you, sir, can you please come up with a template on how to execute this theorem you are coming up with? And today, honestly speaking, I'm so happy with what he is coming up with. Now, what is going to change from there? Number one, let us look at the people constituting the last meeting they had. Professor Jega, let us start from Professor Jega. We knew that Professor Jega was the first chairman of INEC that will conduct a conclusive, not inconclusive now, as it happened during MKO that they did not allow the results to be announced and all that. A conclusive election that is adjudged worldwide as fair in this country. We know that. Since after leaving that office, I have monitored him. I have seen the way he has been going from one country to the other as regards electioneering. All right, let us leave that. Look at Baraje that my other brother mentioned the other time. Yes, he led some people out of PDP to APC. But why did he lead them then? Because they solved the problem that was happening in PDP. Even though he called PDP man, he said, look, we cannot continue like this in this country. And he left for APC. And what happened in APC? I could remember he gave a press conference some time ago that, look, he want APC there not to come in with mercenaries. Because by the time they bring these mercenaries in, they will not be able to handle it. And that's what we are having now. And it is somebody who is so bold to come out to say that. So having said that, you can see that he is somebody that has the interest of the nation at heart. Let us go to Professor Patutomi. We have all known the antecedent of Professor Utomi in this country. We knew him when he was in Volkswagen. We knew all he did there, even though at the end of the day, the system collapsed the whole industrial setup of the country. But thereafter, what has he been doing? I could remember his Patutomi gang there that he was having with some other people like Ayo Teriba and so. And so, thereafter, he also moved and said, look, let us do this in this country. We have all seen that. Now, seeing these people coming up with a group, even though they are planning to transcend to a party, it's not a party here, it's a group. You could see that these are political enigmas in this country that one can, to a very large extent, say, okay, let us work with these people and see what can happen. Because between you and me, angels do not come from heaven to come and get our country.
I was about to ask, the movement from party A to party B in search of, for want of a better word, greener pastures, seems a bit tiring. What about staying in those parties to try to effect this change? Because you've told me already, you've given us their dossier. But if these people that you call strong men and people who have enigma, why can't they stay in those political parties and effect change from within? Moving from one party to the other solves nothing, does it? Because the APC and the PDP or APGA, they all seem to be one and the same. And we see them crisscrossing every election cycle. So starting a third force, really, will it change the crisscrossing? Is there going to be ideologies? It's not just about the persons, but what effects... what change can they effect in reality?
Two things in this now. Two things anybody can see vividly in this. Number one, you can see what happened to APC in the first tenure. Everybody knew then that APC is a party of strange bedfellows. And that was why they couldn't pick who will be here or who will be there. At that time, all they were looking for is any other person except Jonathan. Any other person. So there was nothing like a stable, there was only like a framework of what they are coming to do. That's number one. Number two, you could see that most of the parties on ground now, what ideology are they holding? On what tenets are they built? But look at this group that is unfolding to become a party. I'm not a member yet. I'm only following the personalities there and following everything that they have been doing. Look at them. You can see they say rescue mission, on a rescue mission. And when you are going on a rescue mission, it entails a lot of things. That is to say, you want to change the paradigm. It is high time we change the paradigm of political process in this country. We don't want a situation whereby we have money bags and then be saying, yes, Baba, so we pay. It is you, Baba is saying, you should be here. He's saying, no, we want people that have character. Capacity, compassion, and ability to govern our nation and move us to where we want to be.
All right, let me go back to Mr. Showumi. I'd like to quote Professor Atahiru Jega on something that he said, because we also know that the issue of restructuring and true federalism again becomes a word or a mantra of sorts when it's close to election season. So lots of people keep talking about restructuring, but when it comes down to it, we never see anything done about it, or even the restructuring addressed in any way. Now, Professor Jega said, and I quote, Nigeria is one of the worst models of political accommodation of diversity as well as power and resource sharing. He admitted that there is no, or there are no perfect federations, or for that matter, true federalism. He said, the better framework and structure for the management of diversity, power and resource sharing is in a federation, the more stable, peaceful and socioeconomically developed it would be. Now, again, we see the issue of restructuring and true federalism being brought up. And I struggle with that. What is true federalism? It's either it's federalism or it's not federalism. It's either we're restructuring or we're not restructuring. But here we are again listening to the same things that we heard in 2015 and we're hearing it, we heard it in 2019. And we're in 2023. Why should we pay attention to these people?
Well, in the first instance, I need to explain one thing, why people like Dega need to get involved. I would also make a declaration. I've known Jega since my university days. I know we belong to the same left movement. I know his orientation and thinking in those days and still till now. I knew him as the vice chancellor of BUK and all that. So I can say a lot about his thinking, his perspectives and all that. But how did they come to this situation? When the APC came in, we were campaigning for change. Everybody embraced the issue of change. So many people thought maybe the problem is strong leadership. Let us team up and change the situation. Know that Jonathan was no longer acceptable at that point in time. And I also agree with Dr. Dayo Kaode that anybody but Jonathan, I think he was the one that said that. But the fact of the matter is, after the election, what have we seen? We have seen, it was Adam Soshiomole that first said it, when he was a national chairman of APC. He said, just wave the broom and your sins will be forgiven. So we saw how gradually those facing corruption charges, you know, started moving into APC, and we gradually saw how those cases were being resolved. You know, the records are there for people to see. So we have the recent latest report in the person of Femi Fanikaode also facing ESCC charges. So what will come out of that, we don't know. We had Oji Kalu before him. You know, when you now have the same characters who we've been pointing accusing fingers at, suddenly sleeping on the same bed, you know, with the ruling party, it then becomes laughable. There is no way how people like Jega or Utomi or
Utomi.
Or Adeniro or Prof would not feel that there's something wrong, you know, with APC. I think we need to understand from that angle. It's not a matter of justifying APC or PDP. For me, anything but Jonathan at that point in time was correct. Jonathan did not help matters at all. It was correct to have changed Jonathan. Also, currently, with the state of the nation, where we have been led into almost, you know, brink of collapse, where we are faced with existential threat, where we have seen how armed herdsmen can be allowed to move into our country from neighboring countries to terrorize our local farmers, I think it is time for a new thinking. So maybe because of it, some of these characters came together, you know, to form a new project called
Rescue Mission.
So, and as far as I can see, there is a need for it. We cannot have a true political parties in a multi-ethnic nation like Nigeria. One of the errors which we have made in the past, because and these are done by on purpose, is to make sure that you can have independent candidates. So that even if you agree within your own political party, you can step out and contest. I can give you a very good example. In UK, Martin Bell, who was a journalist and a, you know, had to come out, you know, to challenge for office. And he was elected because he was found acceptable. And the candidates of the political parties were rejected. So we have credible you know, examples of...
The new Electoral Act bill seems to have an accommodation of sorts for independent candidates. It's just, will the terrain allow for it? That's the other question.
That's one. When you have independent candidates, that is one angle of it. We are yet to see it, you know, being implemented in practice. The second point, it's on the existing political parties. How come that political parties are expected to show, or before they can get registered, you know, political association, I mean, that they have a national character? In a federation, that's laughable. There's nothing wrong in I saying I want to form Magodo political party, and my interest is simply Magodo. And then you go and campaign. If people vote for you in Magodo, the party is representing the interest of people in Magodo. And that's all. There's nothing wrong in me saying I want to form a Sokoto State political party, and my interest is just Sokoto State. That is what they call democracy. That is true federalism. Okay. But currently, before a political association can be registered, they must show that they have a national character. Even INEC requires you to have offices in two third of the state. So these are some of the things that should not be happening, which are happening. So when people talk about true federalism, they are actually referring to a situation where all the important ingredients and elements of federalism in democracy are present. It is today, Nigeria is a unitary state, you know, which we called federalism. I'm happy this some issues are not being challenged in court, the issue of stamp duty, the issue of VAT. The moment you get to the root of that, you begin to realize that a new structure will likely emerge. People argue we don't need to collapse Nigeria. I agree with them.
Okay.
But we need to restructure Nigeria in order to get to where we want to be. Again, another question is it those who brought us to our knees that are supposed to restructure Nigeria?
That's a big question that we should ask ourselves. But let me, because we're almost out of time, because you are of the ruling party, the president recently was quoted to say that he does not want to end his tenure as a failure. And to quote Professor Atahiru Jega, he said, "What we have on our hands today is a disaster. We know where we're coming from in this country. We know the average Nigerian, particularly the youths, they look ahead and it's difficult for them to see hope, even under a government that had promised us change." And of course, change means that you're going to give us a turnaround of sorts, but we cannot really say that we've seen that change for the better, can we? So will the APC be able to clean up its mess and get its act together before 2023? Do you see that happening anytime soon?
I agree with your APC as mess. We didn't create a mess. We came.
Okay, maybe you made it messier. You didn't create the mess, but you made it messier.
No, we didn't make it messier either. See, let me just give you a scenario. We have magnified the problems to a point where we're missing the point in this country. See, we have a superstructure and then we have a substructure in every policy. It doesn't matter. For instance, I have common grounds where we agree on issues. My state governor, Yusuf Wike, began the fight on VAT. The Lagos state governor, who is my party man, APC, agrees with him. So when it comes to the issues of who should collect this, we would tend to agree. Once it is about what comes to us, we tend to agree. It doesn't matter what political configurations we belong to. When it comes to giving back to the country, we disagree. So until we deal with that superstructure, we're not going to get it right. That's the point. Until I went to Zamfara State, the national assignment, I did not know that most of what we have as security issues are overblown theories by politicians. For instance, we moved from the Sultan Abubakar International Airport, Sokoto, to Gusau, which is a 3-hour journey by road, and I saw only two police checkpoints. Only two checkpoints. We had only two policemen in our bus. I was in Zamfara for long. I didn't see any security challenge until I left. So I'm not saying the problems are not there, but I'm simply saying that, look, for us to deal with these problems, we have to step out of that political, you know, as if we were like the issues about...
We're out of time. We're out of time.
Yeah, the civil service, the security, and not politicians. You have to deal with them first. Otherwise, it doesn't matter what ideas they bring, they collapse.
Okay.
You have to deal with institutions first. It's not about political parties, yes.
Unfortunately, we have to go. We're out of time. Dayo Kaede is a political technocrat. Bodi Sowunmi is a political analyst. And Sogbe Eli is a member of the All Progressive Congress in River State. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for being part of the conversation. Unfortunately, time is running at lightning speed. Thank you.
Thanks for having me.
All right. Thank you, everyone, for staying with us. We'll take a short break now. And when we return, we look into conversations around the PDP's zoning arrangement. Might it change? We'll get to find out after the break.